Because the necessity is not there already. Then emotion is not there. Then anger is not there. Then sorrow is not there. Then fear is not there. Then jealousy is not there. Where is the necessity to try to commit this sin? But such a fellow many times gets stuck up for some time on the second and third planes, because his actions are guided by emotions and strong impulses. And then most probably he may be reincarnated only in that state. No, it is the strength of the motive which exists on the second and third planes that makes chivalry. But it has a vital difference from all the other cases, because here is a motive which is elevating the personality. If the personality feels that it is for a higher cause, for example, for his country or nation, or to save a group of people, if the motive happens to be such a one, the fourth principle elevates him at the point of death, because the motive is elevating. It elevates him into the spirit of sacrifice. That is what happens with the average military fellow also who dies in the defense line. The fighter in war who dies for a cause, provided he has the motive in his mind, he is automatically elevated without any yogic training or anything, without any scripture or without any teaching. The process is automatic. The weight of the motive lifts him up. Because for a vast group, number of people, he wanted to make a sacrifice. But if he has no such motive, he joins war only for his livelihood, then again the same thing happens what has happened to a suicide. So in such cases the motive decides. And the other preserving, the creator consciousness is called Brahma, and the merging consciousness is called Shiva, and the preserving consciousness is called Vishnu. This also we have seen yesterday. And they will be working like two forces counteracting each other. And the third force is only a force of equilibrium. Just like if you place a pulley and place the string over the pulley, it gives the shape of a triangle. So the third one is only a pulley like principle, which we can call the force of equilibrium. In fact, it is not a third force, but it is the equalizing force of the other two. We have understood some stories and their symbolism of Brahma yesterday. And these three devas are called the Trimurti in the scriptures. They produce three types of forces. The one force is called dynamism. The force the creator produces is dynamism, and it produces atoms from the space. In the language of the scriptures, we can say that it makes the passive space active. And these atoms work out to produce the whole universe,
up to the physical plane. As we have seen yesterday, there are 7 planes of creation. Atoms also exist in many of these planes. Not in all the 7 planes, but in the lower planes they do exist. On the first plane, which we call the physical plane, the physical atoms exist. Those atoms which we know in the present chemistry. In the second plane, called the astral plane, the astral atoms, the difference between the physical atoms and the astral atoms is 49 astral atoms make one basic physical atom. For example, the helium atom, which we call the base atom of the physical principle. For every substance on the physical plane, there are separate atoms of that substance, which form into molecules, and these molecules put together will form the element. And we have the various compounds of these elements in the mineral kingdom. And in the mineral kingdom, there will be an activity going on, which is called the respiratory activity, or the activity of the reversible reactions. That is what is called in the scriptures, the activity between the organic and the inorganic mineral kingdom. Whenever a living being is fertilized, there will be the formation of the organic atoms from the inorganic atoms. For example, when a seed is beginning to sprout and come out into a plant, it takes the minerals of the earth from the inorganic kingdom and transforms into the organic minerals. Like that, every birth causes a change from the inorganic to the organic kingdom. Every death causes the reversible change. That is, from the organic kingdom, the minerals are decomposed into the inorganic kingdom. This is called the respiration of the mineral kingdom, or in the language of the scriptures, it is called the respiration of the earth planet. And this respiration depends upon what we call the cycle of the year. Because the earth is going around its own axis and going around the sun, describing cycles, each cycle producing the seasonal effects along with the fauna and the flora of the creation on this earth. Hence, the respiration of the earth depends upon the activity of earth's double rotation, that is, rotation around its own axis, which we call the diurnal rotation, and the rotation around the sun, which we call the annual path or the ecliptic. So, this activity is continuously going on in the physical atoms. But activity is not possible in the physical matter. Therefore, the activity is going on the astral plane. The changes and their effects are observed on the physical plane. In our body also, the fact that the tissues are maintaining the consistency depends upon not the physical matter of the tissue, but the astral matter of the tissue, a part of which is called the etheric body. This etheric body is directly received from the sun's rays, because a part of the sun's rays that reach the earth form the layer of etheric substance around this earth. In fact, at first, these etheric particles made a whirlpool before the earth was born, and then they caused the physical atoms form to make up the physical earth which we see now. What makes the earth to preserve its form is not the physical matter, but it is the etheric body of the earth. Similarly, what makes the shape of our physical body consistent and protects the tissues from going away is our etheric body and not the physical body. The moment the etheric body leaves this physical body, the physical body begins to degenerate, each into its own basic substances. That which protects the body from getting decomposed while we are living is what is called the etheric body, part of the astral body. So we understand that the astral atoms are continuously pouring into the physical state of atoms, and the physical atoms of the earth are continuously disappearing into the astral atoms. So you find this triangle in the earth's chain actions also. When the astral atoms are being poured into the physical state of this earth, you will understand that the creator is exercising dynamism. And then when the physical atoms are being degenerated into the astral atoms, you will find that Shiva is working and making another force exercised. You can call this inertia. That is how it is explained in the scriptures. And in between, there is what we call the existence. Just as while you are throwing continuously balls to another friend, when the another friend is catching the ball, in the middle you will find a continuous row of balls. That continuum is worked by the third Deva, who is called Vishnu, who exercises a third manifestation of force. It is called poise. These three are called the three qualities of basic nature, because the content of space is called the base substance, which the theosophical scientists call ether. And this triangle occurs in the base substance wherever a creation awakens. Then we say it is called an awakened unit of space. So in the space unbound, we have globes of awakened space. It keeps awake as long as the game of creation goes on. When that spell of creation is completed, this triangle goes into disappearance, and the space becomes passive space. In the meanwhile, there are many active centers in space, each center manifesting the same triangle, just as each seed of the same plant is manifesting the same plant. And these three qualities of basic nature are called in the scriptures in Sanskrit like this. Dynamism is called Rajas. Inertia is called Tamas. Poise is called Sattva. These are called the three basic qualities. So, the Lord Vishnu produces Sattva. Brahma, the creator, produces Rajas. Shiva, the destroyer, produces Tamas. This is one basic formula given with a symbolism in the Indian scriptures. And the content of space on which this occurs is called Prakriti, which means nature. What we call the content of space unbound is called Prakriti. So there is the passive or sleeping Prakriti and the passive or the active or working Prakriti. So Prakriti has alternation of its behavior. That is passive for some time and active for some time. When it is passive, we say that it is dissolution. And in Sanskrit, it is called pralaya. When it is active, it is creation. Then it is called srishti or creation in Sanskrit. And to distinguish between the two stages of Prakriti, the active Prakriti is simply called Prakriti, but the passive Prakriti is called Moola Prakriti. The word Moola means base or basic, just as Mooladhara means the base chakra. Now we'll proceed into another step of the creative symbolism. You have understood that every atom of the physical matter and the astral matter also is built up of units of this triangle. Triangle means only in principle, not in shape. You can say a set of three forces. And the third state, which you call mind, has also this triangle. It has its own atoms. When the mental matter is in dynamism, it produces a space mind which wants to create. And then after some steps, it produces another space mind dissolving. That's why you have the law of action and reaction. Whenever a unit of energy is produced, there are other units of energy that absorb and make it zero. The moment the production of energy is there, there is also the absorption of energy. So two devas are working. One is the deva of inauguration of anything. The other is the deva of closing anything. So as a deputy of Brahma, there is one deva working to move the energy into creation with the help of this energy center, Rajas. There is another deva who is working to close or make the energy zero. In the scriptures, they are called the twin devas. They are described as the twin horses. In Sanskrit, they are called Ashwins. Ashwin means horse. The horse is a symbol of force and its manifestations. And on the mental plane also, the space mind manifests mental atoms, which are thought units of space. Those thought units are called numbers. That is the reason why we do not know what numbers are. though we use them for our calculating purposes. Everyone knows what numbers are, but no one knows what numbers are. If you bring the greatest scholar, greatest professor in arithmetic in all the universities of the world, and make a seminary of all the greatest professors in arithmetic in the world, and ask them to explain you what numbers are, the attempt is only silence. Because anyone can explain you something about numbers. If you ask what 2 is, I can say this is 2. This is not 2, but this is a diagrammatic or symbolic picture of 2. You can say 2. Even that word is not 2, but it is the name given to a number. So we know the names of numbers, and we know the symbols of numbers. We use the numbers. We do not know what numbers are. And I told you how numbers exist in space, how they go on operating continuously, and how they operate in the embryo also, long before the child is having a brain at all. When we had no brain or body, when we were developing in the mother's womb in the form of an embryo, see how number is constantly maintained. 2 hands, 2 legs, 2 eyes, 2 ears, 32 teeth, same number of bones, like that. So numbers are existing as intelligences in space, and this is the theory of the ancient scriptures. And these numbers are continuously operating as thoughts of space. They are called number gods or number devas in the scripture. In Sanskrit, they are called prajapatis. The word exactly means the same as the word patriarch. That is, one who produces us as our father, and one who protects us as our ruler. The word patriarch exactly means the same. Pater means father, arch means ruler. Patriarch means father hyphen ruler. You see the word patriarchs used many times in the Old Testament. The same is meant by the word prajapatis in Indian scriptures. If we read the stories of Abraham, Jacob, we think that they were people who lived in the ancient days, because we are not trained into the science of the symbolism of the scriptures. Without knowing how to study a technical book, if we begin to read that book, we understand some nonsense. Suppose a language professor like myself takes a book of architecture or engineering directly and begin to read it. What can I understand? I can understand the alphabet of it because I know alphabet. But I find words whose meanings I do not know previously. Then what should I do? I begin to interpret them in my own blind way. Similarly, many of us read the scriptures, for example, Old Testament, and read words like patriarch and interpret that they were kings in the ancient days. So the word patriarch or prajapati means numbers who are preparing cycles, and when they make cycles in time, they make little circles in space, and they produce units of space. That is what we call the atoms and the mental plane. They are equal to the thoughts of that space mind. And then 49 atoms of the mental plane make a set of 7-pointed star, and this forms a unit of astral atom. So one astral atom is made up of 49 mental atoms. Similarly, 49 astral atoms make one physical base atom. From this physical base atom, we will have the evolution of the physical atoms of all minerals on this earth. And beyond the third plane of existence, which is called the plane of will or buddhi, which we explained previously, there are no atoms. There is only pre-atomic substance. Similarly, on the 5th, 6th and 7th also. In what state this pre-atomic substance exists? It exists in the form of what they call light. What type of light? It is not the light which can be seen through the eye. What we call light is only optic light. This light is called pre-mental light or supramental light. That is what we call understanding. Whenever this light, whenever our mind is exposed to that light, we say, "I have understood what you are saying." When two people are talking, whenever the one says, "Yes, I understand," that means his mind is once again being exposed to the premental light. That much we can explain. So the first three stages are called in the scriptures atomic stages of existence. They are called Rajo Loka. Rajo means atomic. That is dynamic units. And the remaining four are called Viraja Loka. Loka means plane of existence. The above four are pre-atomic planes of existence. The lower three are atomic planes of existence. So these three devas, Vishnu, Brahma and Shiva, they exist in the pre-atomic stage of existence. And Brahma exists half in the atomic stage and half in the pre-atomic stage, because he is producing atoms from that light. And on the other side, Shiva also exists in the half atomic and half non-atomic state. And whereas Vishnu exists purely on the pre-atomic state, whereas his reflection center exists up to the purely physical state of existence. This is called the phenomenon of inverted triangle. You will find this represented by a symbol in the books of Tantra, which are often misunderstood. So this is called the first tantric unit. Tantra means fabric. That is also a fabrication. So first tantra unit means the first unit of the fabrication of the universe. Of course, there are many details about these triangles. In subdivisions, there are 9 subdivisions in these triangles, into which we are not going to enter today. But it is enough to remember that there are four upward triangles and five downward triangles, which complete the working of the universe. The working of the universe. That means on the inverted plane we have five triangles. On the pre-atomic plane we have four triangles. Put together there are nine triangles. If these triangles are arranged in a beautiful way one upon the other, it is what the tantras say, Sri Chakra. You will find a beautiful geometrical figure which requires a separate explanation when we go into the science of the tantras.